just kind of go into it, so there's no like...
Yeah, everything's rolling.
We'll get into introductions, you know, when we see fit. But yeah, so Daniel used to work at the Catholic Center.
USC Caruso Catholic Center.
And Luke still is a frequent visitor of said.
Well, you know, when you live a life as sinful and licentious as mine, it's important right. to go apologize to God every once in a while.
Right. Okay. How often do you go to confession?
I actually haven't been to confession in like 3 years. So Father Jim, if you're out there, I'll be there soon.
Oh, wow.
But I go to Mass once a week, and then I sing in the choir there, actually. So,
okay.
Yeah, so that's been helpful. And then, you know, this after... recent events, I've decided to start going every couple of days because they do a daily mass there.
Right.
So that's been interesting.
Okay, yeah. So when you say recent events, I know you checked in.
Las Encinas Mental Hospital.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. So like what brought that on? Was it just like you were feeling stressed and you just needed to take a break?
So I am one of those people who struggles with a weird cocktail of mental health issues, right? I have borderline personality disorder, I have depression, I have anxiety, I have obsessive compulsive disorder. And when you have that, if you don't manage it well, and if you don't do your meds all the time, and if you don't see a support group frequently, then sometimes you just go crazy, you know? Sometimes you have suicidal thoughts and all that kind of thing.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So in my case, nothing particular happened. I just was going through a dark phase, and my therapist suggested I go over to the psych ward. So I spent 6 days there. It was a relaxing time, and I think I'm ready to go do other stuff now. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well.
So you have any questions, though, about what it's like on the inside of a psych ward?
Yeah, I was going to ask. Is it like Shutter Island? Is it like that new gore? That what's the new movie coming? Came out? Like, or maybe it's just coming out? What's it called?
No idea.
No, not Split.
Did you see Split?
I did see Split. It's the one with the guy who looks like he's trying to be like Leonardo DiCaprio.
I have no idea.
You've seen the trailer. It's
I don't follow movies until everybody else takes me to them, so I'm not sure which one it is. But
well, have you seen Shutter Island?
I haven't, but I saw the trailers for that, and I was scared shitless, so I decided not to go. So, so in terms of what it's like in a mental hospital, and bear in mind, I've been in a mental hospital for Halloween and for Super Bowl 51, institutionalized during both of those times, right?
Oh, great.
I'm not sure which was scarier, actually, you know. But yeah, so it's a lot of actually people you would assume are kind of normal, you know.
Did you watch the game?
I watched the game in there, yeah. They gave us guacamole and everything.
It was
a
crazy game.
It was. It really was. And having just seen the USC Rose Bowl, USC Penn State, that was another crazy game. It's like, and you know, it was in a mental hospital with a bunch of crazy people, including myself. You know, so crazy everything. So, but yeah, it was an interesting experience. But yeah, you know, I guess this is just kind of my personal like public service statement for people out there. When you go into a mental hospital, you realize that it's a lot of people who have very normal lives, but they just have a particular problem that. Some people are just biologically afflicted with whatever their experience is, right? And there is no shame in getting help if you have those problems. And frankly, a lot of people don't admit it to themselves until they're suffering a lot worse than they need to be. So there's no shame in getting help. So
yeah, I feel like that's a common thing. Where you went to like what's the slang for like the mental hospital, like the loony bin. The pokey would be jail, right? The
pokey's jail, yeah.
There's another one. I've heard.
Asylum, I think, is something they use a lot.
And but it has that like connotation of like, oh, you're fucked up.
Yeah,
you're like, you're crazy. Like you're a murderer or something. Like you're gonna kill my children.
And if you see the actually mentally ill people, I mean, some of them are like that. Yeah, they have special wards for those people, and they need a lot of help. But for the most part, I mean, a lot of it really is just depressive stuff, anxiety stuff, and it's biological and chemical, you know. These people are more a danger to themselves than to anybody else, and that's why I got help, and that's why a lot of us are in there. You know,
movies don't really help out.
No, not at all.
Because like Shutter Island or fucking anything that deals with like. Oh, throw the guy from Psycho in the mental institution.
Right.
Like
I was gonna say, Psycho's probably one of the least helpful ones. So, good movie though. Good movie.
I think, like, in this country, it's not as stigmatized. I mean, there still is some, but, I mean, just imagine being in fucking, like, Nicaragua or some shit, you know, like one of those.
Well, do they even have mental hospitals there?
I mean, they'll put you in like the legit, like,
hole?
One flew over the cuckoo's nest, yeah. One.
The, you know? Jails too, yeah. Sometimes. Like, and actually that's what they used to do with the mentally ill, was just put them in the jail until they could figure out what to do with them.
Yeah. Right.
So.
Which doesn't really help anyone.
No, no. Well, I mean, you think it's bad in like places like America and even Nicaragua. Think about what it's like in North Korea, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Think about what it's like in maybe Iran, which has a strict theocratic law, you know? So
right.
So I go to a liberal university, right? University of Southern California, fight on forever, all that shit. There's a lot of people who are like, well, we need to end the stigma against mental illness and stuff. And I think there's something to that, but I've only gotten support from the public and from
right.
friends, you know, it's not something where people will really like say, oh, you're crazy, I can't talk to you anymore, you know? And I think that's because we have a fundamentally compassionate society, you know? Other societies, North Korea, probably aren't that compassionate about these kinds of issues.
Right.
So, no, I can see that because it's not, because I think psych wards and things like that extends to like drug rehabilitation centers and things like that, where I'm not saying that they're the same thing, mm-hmm. but like mm-hmm. it's people going to seek help.
Right.
People go and they do go to a therapist. They do go to like these places to seek help. Because we watch that shit on TV. We watch, I don't, but like Dr. Phil and Oprah and like all everything. There's a lot of self-help in this country.
Right. Right.
And then in the media, you have like Kanye West going to he's checking himself because of the tour strain. That's what he's like. It's too strenuous for him. But like, but I mean, it's a part of our, there's shows about, what was the show? Like the rehab shows with the celebrity rehab. I think that's what it's called.
Yeah, I mean, there's the regular rehab shows. There's just a lot.
Intervention.
Right.
There's a lot of shows that deal, Hoarders. There's a lot of shows that like deal with that we find interesting because that's not our lives. And it, you know, seeing other people go through shit intrigues us because we're all voyeurs. We all like to watch other people suffer.
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, there will always
be... And get better.
Exactly. And there will always be like those like college activists who are like, oh, why are you profiting off of people's suffering and stuff like that? And yeah, they have a slight point. But I think the fact that it's out in the open is the important thing. You know, even if that does mean some people are making money off of it, but as long as it's out in the open and it can be talked about, I think that's better than it being shut out in the quiet, you know? So,
yeah. I mean, how do you feel about the profiting, though? I feel like, you know, sometimes we forget that these people need to eat, too.
Yeah.
You know? And I get it. If they're, like, if you're getting gouged to go to these places, then I understand. Like, okay. Like, you guys are profiting way too much. But, you know, people that work there got rent to pay, too. They got kids to feed, you know? It's, like, they're supposed to do it for free, you know? Like these things take money. I think a lot of times we forget that.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And, I mean, well, let me ask you guys, number one, are you guys profiting off of me being here? No, just kidding.
Not yet.
I wish.
So one of these days.
I wish I could say
yes.
Yeah.
You know.
Who knows? You might be the one.
We shall see. Well, you know, I'll expect a royalty if that happens, right? So.
Sure.
Absolutely.
But, you know, it's... I don't have much of a problem with it. We live in a media consumer capitalist society. You know, that's just how things go. You know, doesn't bug me a lot. And then especially, I mean, you hinted like, well, these things cost money, like mental health professionals, they do God's work, you know, and they deserve to be compensated for it, especially if they do a good job. So,
right.
Yeah.
You know, in Ireland, the guy that wrote Gulliver's Travels,
Jonathan Swift. Yeah.
He opened like the first mental health clinic, like hospital thing in Dublin.
Interesting.
Yeah,
interesting.
A lot of people don't know that. I mean, I didn't know that, you know.
I didn't know that.
I also found out Jonathan Swift hated children. Gulliver's Travels not supposed to be a kid's book.
Yeah.
That was like a commentary on that.
Well, you know, Jonathan Swift also said in A Modest Proposal that we should eat our firstborns to help control the population of Ireland, you know. So I believe that's what he said.
Yeah, well, now it's all making sense why he opened a mental health place.
So.
That would help with population control, though, if we ate our firstborn.
So speaking of population control, let's talk politics.
Sure.
All right. So, now that we've kind of talked and stuff, So Luke, as you already heard, he went to USC. He's still at USC. And
fight on.
I met Luke at the Language Academy while I was working there.
And I don't know you, but as soon as I saw your face, I'm like, oh, I've seen this guy before. And I know you don't have this. You've never seen me before, or maybe you have in passing. Just
this is creepy, but, Daniel. This is creepy.
But
you work for the CIA.
No, I used to edit videos that you were in, which sounds even more weird.
My past has been revealed. Yes, I have starred in many adult videos. So, no.
Oh, okay. Well, I didn't know that.
No.
No, the videos at the Language Center. I would like. You know, the travel videos that you would like, oh, you go
like
to
the
Disney,
end of the end of the year videos.
Okay.
Yeah, he edited them.
Yeah.
Interesting. Well, thank you for that. Those were always useful.
Yeah.
But Luke is, I know this year you tried to run for city council or an alderman or something?
California State Assembly.
Okay, so an assemblyman. Yeah. Okay, so, and ever since I've known you, you've been like, super interested in politics, and on Facebook you post a lot of articles I find interesting, and because they're you know, we're pretty liberal ourselves. I don't know where we are on the spectrum per se. It depends on the topic. We could go super far left, sometimes we're right in the middle, sometimes we even lean to the right a little bit, but you are a self-proclaimed conservative, right?
Yes.
I've heard you describe yourself as a Hamiltonian.
Yes, I am.
So that's
also
like hardcore like politics for me right there. why don't you...
Well, hold on. Before you get into that, because I think that's going to lead... I want to know what drove you, or maybe these answers can go together, but what even made you run?
So I...
And maybe if maybe if that answer is the same, then
go ahead. Definitely. I started getting more involved in domestic politics because I study international relations formally, right? But I started getting more involved in domestic politics probably in about 2013, 2014. Met a bunch of California politicos. Started going to the California Republican conventions every year and going and doing stuff with local candidates, right? I worked for a guy named Duff Sundheim, who was running for the U.S. Senate seat. Frankly, he had as much a chance of winning that seat as I had for winning the seat in the South Central L.A., right? So I'm white, by the way. That's a joke. I've experienced a little bit of California Republican politics, right? And there's a little group really pleasant little group of South Central Los Angeles Republicans called the South Los Angeles Inglewood Republican Assembly, SLARA. They hold their meetings in Inglewood. There's like all probably 5 to 10 of them, and they're basically all the Republicans in South Los Angeles, right? So I started going to their meetings, and it was pretty fun. It was a good community, good to meet people. I was on their network, right? And one of them, one of the leaders of the group, who's a Republican operative from around here, came up to me after the filing deadline had passed for the 2016 election and said, "Luke, we really need somebody to run for the state assembly district, District 59, against Assemblymember Reggie Jones Sawyer. He can't go unopposed. The people of this district need an option. So can you help us find someone to run as a Republican there?" And I was like, "Well, you guys are all the Republicans I know. But, you know, I am happy to volunteer as tribute if it would do service to my community." Which was a really stupid thing to say, but I said it. And they were like, "Oh, great. This is wonderful. Okay, we'll put you in touch with people." So I became a candidate overnight. Like, it was literally like 12:50 a.m. when I accepted the offer. And I had to go gather a bunch of signatures to go be featured on the ballot, right? Because I was a write-in candidate. I wasn't a formally registered candidate.
Right.
So I had to gather 40 signatures. I spent 2 weeks like knocking on people's doors and standing in front of Safeway and just desperately hitting up my Facebook friends to see if they were registered in the district. And I got 38 signatures.
Oh, man.
So I was running for
the... You found some dead people?
Well, you know, I'm a Republican. We don't get dead people's votes.
Oh, okay.
mostly because dead people wouldn't vote for us. They would die before they voted for the Republican. But but you know, so I ran for about 2 weeks. It was an interesting experience. Did some events. Did some talking to local officials and stuff like that. And it was interesting.
You campaigned. Did you get money?
I didn't get any money, but I did as much campaigning as you can do as a poor broke ass college student who's just walking around in a neighborhood that isn't his. So.
Did anybody mess with you, or was everybody cool? Like,
oh, everyone was cool. Everyone was cool. Well, okay. So there was one guy. There was one guy who like asked me when I said I'm getting signatures to be on the ballot. I asked him, "Hey, would you be willing to help me get on the ballot?" And he's like, "What party are you representing?" And I was like, "Republican." And he just looked me in the eye, gave me an evil stare, and walked away. So, but I wouldn't say that's really messing with you, though.
Right.
So,
I thought he was gonna like he gave you a wedgie or something. I don't know.
It was an interesting story. Someday I'll be able to say like,
are you going
to
do it again?
I don't know. I don't know what my future is. I mean, I'm sure there's a chance that I'll get pulled into running for something again, and I would not be closed to the idea of doing it again. But it's not my goal, you know, like, I have other goals, and, if I ever get called or asked to run for office, or if I ever feel like it's my duty to run for office, then I'll consider it again.
So but, you're like the Batman of politics?
You know, I've been compared to that before, yeah. So
have you really?
So go ahead and consider me Batman.
People have called you the Batman of politics?
They haven't called me the Batman, but they've called me the Dark Knight.
Yeah, not the politician they want. The politician they need.
I'm honored that you would think that.
But yeah, now you can answer Gian's question.
Yeah, certainly. So
like, how did you like align yourself on that side of the political spectrum?
For me, someone, I don't even know what that is. So explain that, what that even means.
So Hamiltonian, right? So I'll explain it in song. No, just kidding. I'll explain it in the context of my own intellectual development, right? And let me know if it gets too boring. Just like cut me off something. Okay.
Give it all.
All right. So I grew up a Republican. I grew up a pretty far-right Republican, watched Bill O'Reilly all the time, read Bill O'Reilly's books. When the Tea Party movement came around when I was in late high school, I was like, yeah, Tea Party, fuck yeah, I'm going to be a Tea Partier. I'm going to go read the works of the Founding Fathers, And so I read the works of the Founding Fathers, right? And the first Founding Father I read was a little old guy named Alexander Hamilton. And there's a million things you haven't done. Yeah. So you guys are in the musical, right?
I haven't seen it.
Have you listened to the soundtrack?
Definitely not.
My sister.
Because I feel like it would do a disservice to the play. I'd have to watch them in tandem, or else what's the point?
That's my thing. It's coming to LA, spring 2017.
I've heard the music several times because my sister's a huge fan.
Okay.
She'd force me to listen to the.
Oh, you were forced to listen to it?
Yeah, well, I'm not a big fan of musicals. It's un-American to me. I know we invented it. But
well, I will tolerate you as a friend long enough to finish this program. So I started everybody's listening to Hamilton. No, I started reading the works of Alexander Hamilton, partly because Lin-Manuel Miranda had just published and performed the first number from that musical at the White House, and it was on YouTube, and I had seen the performance on YouTube. So I was like, yeah, I resonate with this guy. This scrappy little smart, reads everything kind of figure who wants to go be great. I resonate with that. So I started reading Alexander Hamilton's actual works, and I figured, well, yeah, he'd be small government, limited government, free markets, all that kind of stuff. As I was reading him, I realized Alexander Hamilton was definitely not a Tea Party Republican.
Yeah. Okay.
And so I was fascinated, though, because a lot of his other philosophical leanings about human nature and the purpose of government and national greatness, all these things really resonated with me. And I was like, well, where can I learn more? So I started reading throughout my senior year of high school and throughout early college about, number one, nationalists in American history, from Hamilton through Henry Clay and Daniel Webster, John Quincy Adams, Theodore Roosevelt, Abraham Lincoln, up into the present day, the New Deal Democrats, the Rockefeller Republicans, all these kinds of people. And I just had this kind of gradual, it was never an epiphany, it was a gradual realization that I was socially conservative, like not in the like, oh, I'm against abortion and gay marriage sense, but in the sense that like society is worth preserving, and you can't advance anywhere unless you have a basic bedrock of values and a basic bedrock of personal responsibility, right? But at the same time, I favored an activist government and a government that would have social protections for people and would invest in the economy and would manage the economy to the degree that it needed to be managed, right? I became a Hamiltonian, and there's a really great author named Michael Lind, who I try to meet every time I'm in D.C., who's written oodles of books on that, and he was a huge intellectual influence on me. So I wound up just like reading both historians and political scientists and the actual people who wrote a lot of these things and were figures in American history, and I wound up like basically political dead center to the right on cultural issues and to the left on economics and government issues. And that is basically what it means to be Hamiltonian. Yeah. Now, if you want a modern figure who's like that, I would say look at some conservative Democrats like Jim Webb and Joe Manchin, but they're like a certain kind of Hamiltonian. They're more Jacksonian, but moderate Jacksonians, right? And Jacksonians are basically like the white working class, like favors big government programs, but also is socially conservative. I think someone who's closer to the that what I consider true Hamiltonianism would be very moderate Northeastern Republicans or Western Republicans in the old like Rockefeller Republican vein. So people like Governor John Huntsman of Utah, right, who ran for president in 2012. In some ways, Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger of California, who has the greatest accent ever, and I actually had the chance to pee next to Luke Phillips in the bathroom, and I got a selfie with him. It was great.
That was last Tuesday.
Right? Last Tuesday, yeah, the day before I got institutionalized. So, you know, Schwarzenegger scrambles your brain a bit. So Schwarzenegger, I think, is in some ways, not always.
You took a selfie with him in the pisser?
No. Right after the pisser, yeah.
Was it like, hey, Arnold?
No. I said, thank you for what you're doing for your country. And while he was peeing, right? And he was like, and then after that, after we washed our hands, I was like, yeah, can I get a selfie? And he was like, okay, fine. And we got a selfie after right outside. Yeah. So Schwarzenegger is one of these old line moderate Republicans. Other people, Governor George Pataki of New York. I think one of the more famous ones is you find a lot of these people in the defense community. The former Secretary of Defense Robert M. Gates, I think, is one of these like nationhood minded, pragmatic, temperamentally conservative Republicans who isn't dogmatic about government being small or markets being free, but is like does have a really proud Americanism that's relatively open but still very principled, right? Brent Scowcroft, James Baker, Henry Kissinger, everybody hates him, but he's I think he embodies a lot of this kind of stuff. And you know, there used to be an old kind of Democrat called the neoconservative Democrats, right? Scoop Jackson, the senator from Washington, Daniel Patrick Moynihan, great guy, the senator from New York, all these guys, I think. I just think the tradition, to the extent that it lives now, is kind of among some moderate Republicans, but its best exemplar was in the neoconservative Democrats of the 1960s and 1970s. So sorry if this is getting boring to all you listeners.
No. I'm sure there's a niche that...
I'm learning shit.
Yeah, so am I. My biggest, out of everything you just said, why did you stop at Alexander Hamilton? If your whole intent in high school was to read the Founding Fathers, and that was the first one you read... Well, what about the other ones?
Well,
like,
so
why did you? Why, you know what I mean?
No, that's an important question. If you read the works of Alexander Hamilton and fall in love with them, you invariably become a partisan for Alexander Hamilton in a lot of ways.
So what you're saying is you fucked up by reading him first.
You could say that. You could say I also saved myself by reading him first. Either way.
Well, you find out like how much influence he had in the country, like the development of the country. There's a lot of stuff that he did, and I mean, he was never president, you know. But
he would have been a great president if he were.
So, right. Yeah. Right.
Now,
but he never had like that big position like that. But he's still like a lot of the stuff he came up with it's still being used today, and it's a very. That's part of the American political fabric.
It is, and it's not formal. It's a lot of it was informal institutions and stuff, but it was still there. Now, the reason why I didn't, And you know, maybe I was unclear. I did read Thomas Jefferson and James Madison and especially Ben Franklin and a little bit of George Washington to the extent that George Washington wrote everything. Hint, most of the stuff that George Washington, quote unquote, wrote, Alexander Hamilton actually wrote because he was his personal assistant most of the time. So, but anyways, the reason I didn't really delve as deeply into Madison and Adams and Jefferson is that, and I'll admit this isn't the best reason, but it's because I was like, well, Hamilton got most of those things right. Yeah. Most of the questions of the day, I probably would have been a partisan for Alexander Hamilton back then too. After he influenced me, of course. So, yeah, it's a cynical thing, but yeah, that's basically the reason. I do think there's a lot of value in reading Thomas Jefferson and James Madison in particular, in terms of what is American political culture like. Why do we think the way we do about equality? Why do we argue the way we do about checks and balances? Thomas Jefferson is a great mentor for the first of those questions, and James Madison is a great teacher for the second one. But in terms of the practical workings of the American political economy and the American nation state, I think nobody comes close to how Alexander Hamilton's writings are helpful in that sense. So,
was it Ben Franklin? Which of the founding fathers said that you should relook at the Constitution every generation? Was that
every 19 years?
Is that Franklin?
No. Ben Franklin, I think, died before that saying was said. He died pretty early compared to everyone because he was an old guy by that time. But no, that was Thomas Jefferson. I forget the exact quote. If I remembered it, I would give it to you right now because I'm an arrogant prick like that. But
well, my question is.
Yeah. Sorry.
Do you think that it's time to relook at our Constitution? Well, I mean, it's been a little bit more than 19 years.
Yeah. Just about 11 times longer than that, I believe, or 12 times longer. I think we do.
What would you change right now as a Hamiltonian? Like, what do you think needs revising?
Well,
First Amendment, Second Amendment.
I would change the part in the second article of the Constitution that says that citizens must be native-born, just so that we could get Arnold Schwarzenegger to be president of the United States. But more broadly,
well, do you actually believe that? Not because of Arnold, but like, do you think you should actually change that?
I do, because I think there's American identity is broad and assimilative enough that you could have a foreigner who's here for maybe 20 years or 30 years be just as worthy of leading the country as somebody who may not even be as worthy who's been here for their whole life. Yeah.
Well, do you put exceptions to the rule, like, or do you just open it up and say, hey? If America likes you, then you can run.
I would make it a rule, though. It wouldn't just be if America likes you.
My line of thinking is like, you know, let's just say maybe it's not Arnold Schwarzenegger, but let's just, I don't know, who's kind of big that's not really an American.
Suppose Saddam Hussein came and became a citizen.
Sure, if he were still alive and he was here for, and he got enough support, would that be okay?
Yeah, I think it would be okay. I mean, clearly, I do not want.
Obviously,
I do
not
endorse
him
Saddam
specifically,
Hussein.
But like someone else, because isn't that the reason why that exists, to prevent situations like that?
Yeah, but the thing is, I mean, you look at immigrants to the United States, and a lot of them, after 5 or 10 months, even a lot of the time, are basically as American as you can get. You know, the reason it was put in place was to prevent foreign agents from coming in and getting charismatic leaders to come change the country, which, as we've seen in the recent election with the Vladimir Putin's interference, is still something we have to worry about. But I don't think...
Would you think back then it had to do with the English? Like, you didn't want an English guy coming over and then...
Well, I think there was that. I think it was also the French, too, because the French of the Revolutionary France were doing all kinds of crazy shit with trying to influence our elections to get Thomas Jefferson elected, right? That's another story. But
you know, I went to I was in Versailles this summer.
Yeah.
And they had a whole, like, in the castle in Versailles, there was like an entire wing dedicated to George Washington and the American Revolution.
Interesting.
Like there's a George Washington statue in Paris. Yeah. I think there's a Benjamin Franklin statue as well. Like, I saw it and I was like, is that? And then I look and it says, you know, Benjamin Franklin. Yeah. And I was like, oh shit. And then there's like a big statue of Washington on his horse in the middle of like a roundabout in Paris.
Right. Well, you know, they were our greatest ally and probably the single number one biggest reason why the United States became independent from Britain.
Right.
Yeah, yeah, I've seen The Patriot with Mel Gibson.
Yeah.
They come, that one French guy, he helps. And then they come and help at the end. I saw the movie. Yeah.
So I guess my response to, if I could put it in a single question, single thing is, you are just as likely to have treasonous domestic natural citizens as you are to have...
Are you talking about Hillary Clinton?
No. I'm talking about Jefferson Davis. Yeah.
That was a joke.
I know.
But no, Jefferson, I think that's a good one too.
Yeah. And you're just as likely to have people betray the Constitution from inside as you are to have a foreigner...
Homegrown terrorists.
There. You could call it that. Or homegrown traitors, or however we're going to say it. But yeah, I want to go back to another point.
Go ahead. Yeah. Sorry for interrupting.
No worries at all. So in my opinion, the informal changes to the Constitution have been more important and more long-lasting and more beneficial than the formal changes to the Constitution, the amendments, right? Bigger
such
things.
Such as?
So in the Civil War, nobody wrote an amendment that says the Union will be supreme and there shall be no more secession, but it was a principle established by political events that happened, including the defeat of the South and the legislation passed by the Northern Congress, that it became a principle that wasn't broken. The Union became a principle that it had never been for the 70 years prior to that.
Well, I don't know if you heard, but CalExit is going to be a thing now. So
I have strong feelings about those sunshine patriots and traitors. So,
so we'll see how strong the Union is.
But it lasted for 150 years, though. It lasted for 150 years as a principle. And
I don't think that's... I was just kidding.
I know.
Okay, so what else?
So the New Deal. The New Deal. Nothing in the New Deal is formally sanctioned by the Constitution. But nobody questions nowadays, with the exception of some kooks on the far right, whether Social Security is part of the American social contract or whether Medicare is part of the American social contract. The notion that government has a positive role in helping preserve a quality of life for its citizens was something that was developed for about, I would say, well, you know, there's basics of it all the way to the founding, but it was really developed from the Progressive Era up until the New Deal, and it was institutionalized in the New Deal. Never had a constitutional amendment. Some constitutional amendments helped, like this, the Income Tax Amendment, right, 16th Amendment. But most of that was done through just legislation rather than tinkering with the constitutional structure. So I think the important changes that are going to happen in America in the next 20 or 30 or 40 years, which are going to be really important years, I think, those are going to be more done through the political process rather than the constitutional process, like rebalancing American federalism, figuring out how to restructure entitlement programs, figuring out how to pay for infrastructure, those kinds of things you don't need a constitutional amendment for. Now, there are things that probably do need constitutional amendments, right? I don't think campaign finance or abortion or climate change or any of these hot button things are those. But people have serious concerns about the Electoral College, right? And maybe there will be a constitutional amendment in the future if the Democrats gain a supermajority.
I have a problem with it.
Yeah, say again?
I have a problem with
it. Yeah, yeah. That's a very valid reason from a small D Democratic sense. Yeah. So change might come there, but I don't think that will be the biggest change. Anyways, go on about that.
No. I just have a problem with it. I just feel like we're in the 21st century now. We're not in the 1700s anymore. We don't vote by horseback. We should be voting online. We should be able to vote through our phones. There should be some sort of like online registry.
I mean,
you should be able to register like the day of voting and still be able to vote. It should be a holiday.
I mean, I feel like the creation of the Electoral College wasn't on the up and up in the first place. Like, it was created so because they didn't think it would ever work, so that Congress could select a president every single time, you know, and under the guise of trying to like give everyone an equal say in the selection of the president. But it's not once has it gone to Congress for a vote. So the plan
It did. Yeah, the election of 1824, which actually was viewed as a corrupt bargain election because some of the votes were traded for political positions. Right, my own favorite antebellum statesman Henry Clay became Secretary of State because he made sure a lot of votes got cast for John Quincy Adams, which pissed off Andrew Jackson and all of Andrew Jackson's supporters.
Okay,
yeah. So there has been one of those, and it wasn't pretty at all.
Right.
Yeah. You know,
I mean, if that would have happened this year, it wouldn't have been pretty either.
Oh, my God. Yeah, yeah.
You know what's ironic about everything you just said? Like, I didn't know that. Or maybe I did at some point hear it through something. That's not shit you learn in school. It's not. And it should be.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you're privy to stuff like that happening, then you're just a more informed voter. I don't know who said this. I don't know if I was listening to it on a podcast or it was a movie or something. But I think it was a podcast. I think it was Joe Rogan, probably, most likely. How he was saying, or someone was saying, that immigrants are more informed about American politics than Americans are.
You are exactly right about that, by
the
way.
Because they have to take the fucking test to become
citizens. Oh, yeah, they make
not
you...
Not like foreign, but like people who are actually trying to become citizens.
They
have
make
to learn
you
everything.
Learn the shit out of everything.
Right.
And that they don't teach you in school. Right. There's plenty of people that have graduated high school in this country that, I mean,
I'm one of them
into
a certain extent.
Yeah, I just started kind of learning. I mean, Luke is a big reason. I started reading a lot of the articles that Luke shares.
Well, I appreciate
it. I'm learning
that.
A lot of stuff. No, I mean, I always... You know, that's the reason why I wanted John here, is because you post these articles, and they weren't necessarily from the websites that I would, you know, go to for news, which kind of, like, let me realize... Yeah, Breitbart's my favorite.
For the record, I have a friend at Breitbart. I do not read Breitbart, so...
Oh.
Yeah, people need jobs, you know? it made me... Some of the articles you posted made me kind of question, like, all news media, you know? Like, it's just, like, everybody's got... It's something that I really, like, don't like. I feel like this year or this past year more than anything is, like, every article you see is clickbait. Everything is, like, it's definitely, like, if it's HuffPost, it's definitely, like, left-leaning. Like, for example, Donald Trump, you know, the thing he passed about the abortions in other countries. That turned into a big thing. Oh, Donald Trump's doing this. And it's, like, no. Like, every Republican president has... taking that thing away,
right.
And when a Democratic president comes in, he puts it back in. It's been happening since Reagan.
It's a football kind of thing.
Yeah, it's like not a big deal. Like,
I didn't even know about that until the BuzzFeed article that wrote about it, and then
exactly
the way they framed it was like he removed fund like something that happened that affected Americans, and it doesn't affect. But that was the title. It was like, oh, Trump signs new executive order removing abortion funding or something. Literally, that's it. But when I read it, I'm like, wait, this has to do with... We were giving money to foreign countries for a... Why?
So their babies don't come here as fucking illegals?
Is that really what it is?
I don't know. I'm just making that up.
It's immigration policy, not foreign aid policy. That's
but my point is, though, like, you read in a headline like that, and someone like me or you, not you, but like us, we read that, and it kind of like pisses us off. Just from the title, like clickbait, right? Most people... would probably fucking just see that, share it on Facebook, and then keep scrolling. They don't read it. Because when I read everything.
And I think that's the shitty part about Facebook, is now, like, you're only discussing like-minded people now.
Yeah. It was supposed to expand your horizons, and sometimes it does.
Sometimes.
But that's not what
it does.
Nobody likes to read the articles. They only like to read the headlines.
Yes.
It expands your focus if you... let it expand your focus, and you're willing to let other people enter your news feed. But now they have all these algorithms that, like, if you like these certain articles, they're going to continue to push, like, these certain people up to the top. So that's all you're seeing is, like, similar articles from whoever the fuck, insert BuzzFeed, Huffington Post here, whatever. But, you know, like I said, when I was reading that article, I'm like, we were giving money to... It's just... That is a way where you can save money for our country... to do something else with that money. I don't know what, because there's a lot of fun.
But then you got to kind of question, why was that created in the first place?
I don't know why it was. Yeah. I mean, obviously I'm uninformed. I'm uninformed about a lot of things.
I am too, frankly.
There's a lot of things that are becoming issues now. And I think this was your point. They're becoming issues now, and they've always been issues. You just said that, you know, where like all of a sudden... because Trump has kind of reignited Americans' like involvement in politics. Just Trump, Bernie, like this whole year and a half, like you said, has kind of just reignited our interest in it.
You know, I don't know if reignited is the proper word.
Okay,
I think it's
getting people on board for the first time.
I think that's a bigger part of
it. Okay, well then, but I mean, saying though, like all of a sudden, all of these nominations that Trump just got confirmed, like all of a sudden people give a shit about who's going to be elected to, you know, the education, Secretary of Education and our security. Like all of a sudden people care, but people who, I'm sure if you went down the line, well, everyone's had their problems, but not one person shared anything.
Well, is this not the first demagogue we've had as president?
Well, you know, I actually don't think Trump is all that unique. I think he's unique in that he has no experience in government.
And he's a celebrity.
Though, I mean, Reagan was a celebrity, kind of. Not the same level of celebrity 21st century Trump is.
At least Reagan was a political activist.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Trump, well, aside
was,
from
the, at least he was a governor for
a while. He was. He had political... Because I had to... I had to learn about Ronald Reagan.
Right.
Even if he was a scab and a snitch.
He was.
I'm actually not a big Ronald Reagan fan. I respect him, but I don't really like him, you know, that kind of thing.
Right.
So, well, he's the god of the Republican
Party. He is. That's something I want to change. I want to make it Dwight Eisenhower or maybe even President Richard Nixon, the greatest Republican president of all time, even greater than... but, you know, I work at the Nixon Library, so I study that a lot, too.
So... let's switch it up a little bit. Why is, I could tell you like Nixon.
Yeah.
Why is Nixon such a, he's got kind of a...
Because he's going to be impeached, dude. That's why.
Well, I know he stepped down and I'm not a crook and all that, but
I am not a crook.
Is it because he came in during the Vietnam War and then he kind of like, just people, you know, like looking back what he did, you know, the only Nixon stuff I know is I watched Nixon, the Oliver Stone movie. Yeah. I know you why you're like, you
which
know,
was a great movie.
Yeah, and you're like, you know, he wasn't that bad. Like he wasn't like a terrible guy.
He was human.
You know, yeah. But when we look back, people, you know, I mean, there's stuff in there like he didn't cheat on his wife like every other politician did. Right. You know, things like that. They were admirable and stuff. And he was also paranoid and
really spied on people.
Yeah, he did. Yeah. That's definitely shit.
So here's my thing on Nixon, right? I admire him as a tragic statesman and a great American, right? And I don't necessarily admire a lot of his character, though I find his character to be fascinating. My main fascination with Nixon is in the policy stuff and that legacy of strategy and policy that he represents, though his character is also fascinating. Before I get to the policy thing, let me just do a quick aside. Alexander Hamilton was basically the Nixon of his age.
Really?
All kinds of scandals, all kinds of people going against him for things that he really deserved to be going against for.
Like what?
So there was the Reynolds pamphlet, which all fans of Hamilton know about now, where Hamilton cheated on his wife, but people thought he was embezzling, and to prove that he wasn't embezzling money from the government, he had to admit that he was cheating on his wife. Destroyed a lot of his career. His career was already destroyed already, though, because of another scandal. And the other scandal was he ripped John Adams a new one while he was working for him. He published a pamphlet under his own name on why John Adams was unfit to be president of the United States while he was working for President John Adams. So all kinds of this stuff, certainly not illegal in the fine print sense, just like a lot of the stuff that Nixon has on his record, but still very unethical, very, very unethical. And, you know, probably the tipping point, I think, for a lot of people who otherwise would have been Hamilton fans is that in 1798, during the Adams administration, we were verging on war with France. And President John Adams, to his credit, skillfully avoided that war. Alexander Hamilton took an order that Adams gave him to start preparing an army in case we were going to go to war with France, and took a lot of liberties to prepare that army for war with rebellious Virginians. He was starting to, in a lot of people's view, foment a civil war to establish a new political reality where the North was purely dominant over the South, right? And so, again, like a lot of the stuff with Nixon, it's never been conclusively proved that any of this stuff was illegal. It's never been conclusively proved that any of this stuff was something that should destroy someone's reputation. But the fact of the matter is it did destroy his reputation, and there were a lot of shady, unethical things about it, just like in Watergate and just like in some of the other scandals Nixon was involved in, right? So if you want to know why Lin-Manuel Miranda had to resurrect Hamilton's legacy, it's because Hamilton has always had a dual legacy as both a great statesman and a great intellectual, but also as one of the most hated men in American politics for the whole time since Weehawken. And so when I look at Nixon, I see like a brilliant mind who was cut short in his political career due to his own tragic faults and due to his own just basically human faults, similar to how Alexander Hamilton had it. So that's that. But you want me to talk about Nixon too? Why I think his policy stuff is interesting? Or you want to comment on the other stuff first?
You comment. I mean,
who would be on your Mount Rushmore?
Oh, that's I wouldn't change Mount Rushmore. I wouldn't change Mount Rushmore. I might add Franklin Roosevelt to put another Roosevelt up there, but I wouldn't take Jefferson off. I disagree with Jefferson on a lot of things, but I think Jefferson really forged a lot of the American soul. You know. Democracy, liberty, all that shit.
So you like Teddy Roosevelt?
I love Teddy Roosevelt.
So let me ask. So this is going to segue to another thing that's going on right now.
And let me talk about Nixon later.
Sure. We'll talk about Teddy Roosevelt now. I'm just going to ask. What's your opinion on the Dakota Pipeline?
So I support it. I think the Obama administration's order should not have been overturned, however. And I think it was perfectly okay to reroute the pipeline, and that they should have done that earlier because it would have solved a lot of like the protest issues and stuff like that. That said, I'm not intrinsically opposed to pipelines going through this stuff. And from my reading and from my understanding of this very complicated issue, a lot of the protests that were happening were happening by people who were not affiliated with the tribe and who were not affiliated with Native Americans at all, but came just for environmentalist reasons. And the tribe was consulted and did not fully cooperate with the Army Corps of Engineers and other people doing permits. So there was nothing technically wrong about the pipeline going over that land. That's my complicated opinion on it. If I just say yes, pipeline, I know I'm going to get a lot of flack. But
well, yeah. The reason why I ask, because you said add another Roosevelt.
Yes.
And Teddy was very much
an environmentalist.
And for public lands and mm-hmm. things like that.
Right.
And once you open the door to pipelines, mm-hmm. you start, it's almost like opening Pandora's box. If you just start, yeah, it's one pipeline now. Obviously, there have been other pipelines. I was just in Texas, and there's the beach that I was at in Galveston, there's a fucking pipeline on the beach.
Right, right, right.
And so it's not like anything that's new, but once you start allowing more and more, because that's, in my opinion, that's Trump's business first, everything else second, well, where does that end?
Well,
meaning, do you start selling public lands? Because I'm opposed to that.
Yeah, I am too.
Because that's something, that's business, but at the same time, we're like one of the only countries where you can just go camping, you know, or whatever, go to Yosemite mm-hmm. and do whatever, because it's we own it, right?
So I agree with you. I have caveats to that agreement, but I generally agree with you. And one of the caveats is, what was Teddy Roosevelt really based on, right? At the turn of the 20th century and the end of the 19th century, there were basically two schools of conservation, right? Well, three schools if you want to add the people who just didn't like conservation and were the Trumps of the era and totally pro-business. You had the John Muirs who were like, we need to preserve everything. And there were the Teddy Roosevelts who were like, we need to manage resources for future use for our future generations in the interest of national prosperity and also human good, right? And so the John Muir camp was influential in setting up the national park system and eventually was more influential post-1970s. The Teddy Roosevelt camp was influential in getting stuff set up like the Department of, or the Bureau of Land Management, a lot of the interior departments, things like the Forest Service's Department of Agriculture, but it was also set up around that time, right? So in my view, conservation policy has to take both things into account, resource use and resource management, but also public enjoyment and natural preservation for preservation's sake. And so with the Dakota Access Pipeline, I see that as something that if it ever were conclusively proved that it was Indian burial grounds and it were sacred lands and stuff like that, which I've never seen a fully convincing argument that it was, then of course, take the pipeline out and send it another way, right?
Well, see, my thing is, not to interrupt you.
Yeah, good.
And this is going to sound really ignorant. I don't care. But I don't give a shit about that.
Okay.
In terms of like the burial grounds or whatever, because for me, it's more than just that.
Right.
To me, it is an environmental issue.
Okay.
To me, driving a pipeline through land will screw up the ecosystem there. I mean,
there's always going to be leaks and stuff.
It's not going to be perfect, right? And you know, when we have things like, because it's not just Flint, but I'm going to use Flint because it's the one, you know, where our water's not great. Our whole infrastructure. I was reading an article. Maybe you shared it about our pipes are so shitty that like we're pretty much all poisoned right now. Because we need to redo all of our piping because it's just, I forget what it is, copper or whatever it is. Like after a certain amount of years, it just starts to deteriorate. But anyway, but for me, it is an environmental issue because in my mind, oil and things that are based, like to me, that's the old way of thinking.
Right, right.
It is. And so like that's one of my biggest things, and not about global warming or whatever, but...
Just
oil is not the way of the future.
Right.
It helped us get to where we are now, and it's going to continue to like push us forward. But solar, electricity, those are really where the renewable. That's the ultimate. If we can harvest the sun, we don't have to worry about energy at all.
You have a very moderate point of view on this, and I appreciate that a lot. A lot of people are like jihadists in terms of like, oh, well, oil is fine and there's no problems with it, or like crusaders in terms of like, we have to get rid of oil now because it's going to destroy the environment. We need solar now, kind of thing. You have a very moderate take on it, which I appreciate a lot. And I think people like you have better solutions than people in the other camps. So here's my thing. I think oil is, for better or for worse, and natural gas too, is for better or for worse going to be here for a while.
Yeah, just fracking because is terrible though.
Well, I actually like fracking, but we can agree to disagree. It's just because of the cost effectiveness of it. It's we have an infrastructure that supports oil for vehicles and oil and gas for conversion into electric power, right? At orders of magnitude more than we have infrastructure for wind and solar and nuclear, stuff like that, right? So I actually think we do need to try to, within the next couple decades, maybe it's going to take longer than that. It probably will take longer than that. Transition to a renewable energy economy. My favorite is nuclear energy. I know a lot of people on the left don't like that. That's fine. But we need to be investing more in things like hydropower, solar power, wind power. I would say nuclear power. Not everybody would, but this kind of thing. And but it's a long-term process, and in the interim,
you need to have oil.
You need to have oil. You need to have gas.
I understand that. I get that.
I mean, here's my issue with oil in general. It's and it's actually really it's close to where we're at now, Los Angeles. You know, at the beginning of the 20th century, Los Angeles had one of the best public transportation systems in the nation.
Okay.
And the car industry said that doesn't work for us. Let's get rid of this. Build these freeways and force people to have cars. And now you have like the wasteland that is Los Angeles, you know, like it's basically a bunch of neighborhoods connected to each other by a freeway, all because the car industry wanted people to buy cars. And I feel the same way about oil. Like I know that there has been like technological advances way before now, like 30, 40 years ago. And every time somebody comes up with a different kind of energy source,
they shut it down.
The oil industry buys it to get rid of it, you know, like, you know, the combustible engines, whatever, between the car industry and the oil industry, the guys running the show behind the curtains, you know, they want to get rid of it. So I feel like we've already could have been transitioning out of it, you know, especially because we know it's not necessarily a renewable source, but there's a few, and maybe this is me getting too conspiracy theorist here, but there's a few people in charge who make a lot of money, and they're at the point where all they care about is money. They don't give a shit about anybody else.
And if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Well, I think there's a lot of truth in that, but I also think that just at a certain level, I mean, we have Teslas, right? We have hybrids.
Yeah, but look how expensive it is, though.
Exactly. Well, but here's the thing. There has to be two components to any big transition, right? There needs to be the political will to move it, and there needs to be the cost effectiveness to make it mass produced, right? And so so I think you have a lot of the political will actually with green energy, with electric cars, with public transit, to emphasize these over other kinds of energy. I mean, in California especially, and I do a little bit of research on this stuff, in California especially, we set guidelines on how much energy we have to get from renewable sources and how much funding is going to go to JPL and Bell Labs and all these places for renewable sources and all that kind of stuff. But it never manages to take root beyond a certain threshold at current levels, in my opinion, because the technology just isn't there yet. Or it's there, but it's not in a commercially viable form yet, or whatever the reason.
So we need
more political will to do it, but we also, and I think the political will needs to focus right now on the basic research and applied research side rather than on the let's get everybody to buy electric cars side.
Right.
And it's possible, it's very possible for these technological revolutions to happen very quickly, but the research stuff goes incrementally for a while and then it like shoots up every once in a while, right? And I think we just are nowhere near that threshold, and there's a lot more public investment and frankly just public will needed to go into that. And as long as oil is cheaper, people aren't going to buy electric cars.
That's why people buy shit made in China.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's why I'm fat, because it's easier to go to McDonald's and, you know,
right,
feed myself off that as opposed to like spending $10 on a salad at Whole Foods. That's not how much it costs. But you know what I'm saying.
So I hate to cut this. We're getting at that time. Luke's got some prior engagements. So before we go, let's just jump right into it. Let's talk Trump. Let's put 10 minutes in. How do you feel about Trump at being a lifelong Republican?
First off, let me preface this. This is going to be a great conversation. It's going to be a terrific conversation. Yeah. Let me tell you, it's going to be the world's greatest conversation. And wrong. I mean that in every sense of the word.
Wrong.
I don't particularly like him. I don't have the same knee-jerk opposition that everybody has on the social issues side. I think he has brought some important questions back to the public debate, and I disagree with him on most of those questions, but I'm glad we're having those conversations now. You know, immigration, you know, is something that's been broken for 30 years. We need to figure out how to fix that. His solutions are terrible, but he's brought it back into the public debate.
You don't like the wall around Mexico?
No, I don't like the wall
around
Mexico. And, you know, it's me. I've never met an infrastructure project I didn't like, but that's one that I don't particularly like. I don't think it's a racist policy, but I don't think it's a smart policy.
You don't think it's a racist policy?
No, I don't. Because I think, I mean,
where's the Canadian wall?
Well, you don't have a lot of immigration coming from Canada.
That's not true.
Yeah.
A lot
not
of people
in the levels most, that
sure, maybe, and maybe this is just my little small bubble that I'm in, but most of the people I know came from Canada.
Really? Interesting. Interesting. Well,
people,
I'm not an immigration policy expert, so I would
that's
have to
what I'm saying. Maybe it's just my bubble.
Right.
But one of my mom's coworkers is from Iran, and that's how he got in, was through Canada. Not illegally, but it was just easier for him to come
and do the visa process.
Do everything from Canada.
Right.
As opposed to the other way around.
Well, the other thing, too, is most immigrants don't actually come across the borders. Most immigrants
just fly
come
in
at airports or at seaports, kind of, mostly airports nowadays. So what do I think Trump means for the rest of things? I look at Trump like Herbert Hoover or James Buchanan or the last president of the Articles of Confederation, Samuel Huntington. I think he's like the epitome of what's been wrong with American politics for quite some time, and he's like a reactionary attempt to kind of not necessarily shore up the system, but like do an alternative, you know. And it's gonna fail. It's gonna fail.
I was gonna say, do you think he's gonna get reelected?
I don't think so. I hope not. I hope he's impeached, frankly. Because I think we need somebody with more
Mike
wisdom.
Pence?
I think Mike Pence, at the very least, is a stable personality. I disagree with him on a lot of things. He's a standard run-of-the-mill conservative. I disagree with that. But he's at least stable. I don't see Mike Pence as being fundamentally different from George W.
Like,
Bush.
He looks like he would be an Indiana Jones Nazi villain.
Well, at least Nazi villains, despite being Nazis, are at least institutionally like capable of running things. Yeah, I'm not justifying Nazis, but
Donald Trump's a fascist, don't you know? The whole administration's a fascist.
But see, here's the thing with Donald Trump. He's not a fascist. Fascism is a very definitive kind of thing that is a lot more status than anything Donald Trump would be doing. Because bear in mind, Donald Trump is bringing all these small government kooks into his office, right? So he's not a totalitarian in that sense. I see Donald Trump as a standard run-of-the-mill American populist. Say again?
A hypocrite?
A hypocrite in a lot of ways, in many ways. But he's nothing we haven't seen before with, like, George Wallace, Patrick Buchanan, these kinds of people. And I just think he represents some of the worst of our national qualities. But in a way, and there's a theory that, like, every 30 or 40 years, or usually every 80 to 90 years, there's, like, some cataclysmic event that forces the hand of the national leaders and forces us to rethink our institutions. I think Donald Trump's presidency and whatever great crisis comes out of his presidency, because I think it's on the way, is that event. And we're going to start rethinking our institutions based on models we've set up in the last couple decades once we realize this shit ain't working, you know?
I would agree with that. I'm seeing that on Facebook. Like, just not that Facebook's a representation of the country, but, like, as what we were saying earlier, people are finally starting to, like, click on and starting to pay attention. Hopefully nothing fucking actually serious happens, like a civil war or anything like that. Something, yeah. Like, just hopefully it's just Trump being elected.
I mean, I don't think it'll get to that. I mean, people are angry. We got protesters, whatever, whatever. But they're very, like, you know, they're all in the major cities.
Just imagine, and I was thinking about this the other day. But I think
people, like, I mean, I've said this.
Just imagine the pipeline situation, right? And there's people protesting, and they're like, they're not moving. And it gets to the point where Trump has to make a decision. Okay, am I going to send the National Guard in to, like, forcefully remove them? Because I have the power to do that. Like, how, I forgot what president did that for the unions and things like that. And
so Teddy Roosevelt did that. Dwight Eisenhower did that. A lot of people have done that.
What I'm saying is, what if we're getting close to that edge, that breaking point, and let's say that he sends the guard in and people get shot and killed.
Yes. Yeah.
That could lead to riots. Right. I mean,
it could lead to riots and stuff, but I think that'll unify people more than.
Oh, like, I'm not saying split people. I'm not saying it like, you know, that. I mean, that's gonna that's more lead to more violence.
That's more an attack on the government, you know. I mean, my brother's a veteran, and he's like happy about the old general, whatever his name
Mattis,
is.
Mattis, yeah, James Mattis, because, probably the last sane person in the
administration. Right, because he doesn't take shit, and he's not afraid to tell Trump, "No, you're wrong," you know, right. And that's like. I feel like he'd be involved.
Not to be confused with the other general in Trump's circle, Michael Trace? Flynn. Michael Flynn, who's a cuckoo, wacko, like, crazy guy. So, Mattis is the same one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I know people who like him, too. Same situation.
Yeah.
No nonsense.
Right.
He'll tell you to go fuck yourself.
Yeah, exactly.
And use those words, most likely.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But, yeah, we can, you know, I don't want to keep you. But
oh no! This I enjoyed has been a great
like
time.
Yeah, definitely. I want you to come back.
We learned a lot. Yeah, that's yeah.
For sure.
We'll try to figure out another day where we have a little more time. I mean,
sounds
it's
good
all,
to me. Yeah,
I'd be love to have you and kind of delve a little deeper.
Yeah, I would love to, and we'll figure out like what we're going to talk about so I can prepare some stuff. But I really appreciate the opportunity to come speak here. I really do. I'm honored, and I'm happy to meet you guys and do this stuff. And I look forward to talking shit with you guys again.
All right. And if you got anything you want to plug, yeah, like your Twitter handle, I know you write some articles for a website, right? You want to plug, go for it, man.
Yeah, I'm not very active on Twitter, but I do have a personal website, LukeNathanPhillips.com. Pretty straightforward, you know. And if you want to see...
How do you spell Phillips?
Two L's.
Two L's. Okay.
And not an F, it's a PH. Just in case you were wondering. So yeah, you can find my personal professional website there. And you know what? Fuck it. If you want to friend me on Facebook, just shoot me a message that says, "Hey, I listened to your show. I'm interested in talking to you, and I would be happy to have a conversation with you." You can also probably email me because I think I have my email address on the website. But yeah, look out for my articles. I publish them all on my website, and I write for a couple publications around here. So happy to start conversations with anybody who's interested. And I apologize ahead of time if I offended you.
No, you didn't. I don't think you offended anyone.
Yeah, you should listen to our other episodes.
Yeah.
Way more offensive.
Yeah. Well, I'll work on that for next time.
Okay. All right. Well, that's going to do it. You guys know the drill. DNGtalk.com. We'll see. This will probably be up in a couple days.
Tomorrow.
Next episode, who fucking knows?
But, next week sometime.
Next week sometime. So I'm out. Deuces.
Fight on.
Fight on. That's it.
All right. Hey.